Hello guys, Moidal here. Today we'll be taking a look at the history and progression of one-time events in World of Warcraft. We've just had one in Classic with the opening of the Gates of Ahn’Qiraj, and the Scourge invasion marking the release of Naxxramas will be soon to follow. In Retail we'll have one soon as well, Death Rising, that helps set the stage for the upcoming Shadowlands expansion. You could argue the details of the term one-time event, but for the purposes of this video, I've followed the classifications found on the WoW part of Gamepedia. I'm generally a great fan of one-time events, and I wanted to get a better view of their history and how exactly they've evolved over the years or maybe regressed. Have they become better or worse? The first one-time event was the opening of the Gates of Ahn’Qiraj, and what a way to kick things off. The event had many epic features, a challenging quest series that tested even the best of players, a huge scale culmination in Silphus with the ringing of the Scarab Gong, and the battles that ensued not just in Silphus, but in many zones throughout Kalimdor. It was an event that cemented itself in the history of WoW when it happened, and it has since received somewhat legendary status in the community. But yet, it was never really repeated by Blizzard in future events. There were problems with funneling a lot of players into a small area within a single zone when the actual gate openings happened, and the war effort wasn't the greatest success. We never saw any event-specific quest series with the same type of finale as the Scepter of the Shifting Sands either, but there were some parts that were repeated. The continent-wide invasions that happened in Kalimdor with the ringing of the Scarab Gong would lay the foundation for many events to come. One of them being the Scourge invasion in patch 1.11 that helped mark the release of Naxxramas. Here, Blizzard really went all in on the idea of a worldwide invasion, kicking it up a notch from the continent-wide invasion we'd seen with the opening of AQ. New Scourge enemies appeared in various zones spread over both Kalimdor and the Eastern Kingdoms, but also the capital cities and Undercity and Stormwind in particular would be under attack this time. By fighting back the Scourge, you could earn so-called necrotic wounds, which was a currency added specifically for the event that could be used to buy various items. The invasion was so much of a success that it returned just before the release of Wrath of the Lich King with the name Zombie Infestation. Many of the features were the same, but there was an extra element of a zombie plague where both friendly NPCs and players could turn into zombies. It was a really cool addition in my opinion, with many small details, and that part would also end up being reused. In fact, it's used in the Death Rising event that'll go live in Retail soon. In Death Rising, the main new addition is an update to Icecrown, where players get to do a variety of quests and battle old Wrath of the Lich King bosses that are being reanimated. Those events are the exception, however, and most of the other ones don't have so many of the exact same components. I don't really mind it myself as long as those components are cool, and a zombie infestation in an MMO definitely fits that criterion. Going back to vanilla, at the very tail end before the release of the Burning Crusade, we had the Dark Portal Opens event. Another awesome concept in my opinion, with demons flooding out of the Dark Portal and invasions happening in different zones across the world. It's a bit of the same theme as we've seen already, with a new threat appearing and disturbing the quote-unquote peace. But a twist to the Dark Portal Opens event was the addition of a world boss, High Lord Krul, that had multiple spawn locations including many of the starting zones. There are many old videos on YouTube of him wreaking absolute havoc in a lot of the capital cities. Getting killed in a capital city by a world boss is kind of annoying, but it's awesome at the same time, and I think it's something that makes a huge impression on new players in particular, seeing a giant demon running amok in a supposedly safe city. The Dark Portal Opens event did have its problems. Similar to the opening of the Gates of AQ, a lot of pressure was put on a single zone, the Blasted Lands in this case. There was only a single quest associated with the event that required you to kill demons at the Dark Portal. Many players were probably eager to complete the quest fast, and with the area around the Dark Portal being relatively small, all the settings were there for some lag spike invasions. The Burning Crusade was released, and we had a lull in one-time events for a while. It would be over a year until the next one that happened with the release of patch 2.4, the Sunwell patch. The event was the Battle for Sun's Reach that had a very different flavor to what we'd seen earlier. The battle for Sun's Reach took place only in a single zone on the Isle of Quel'Danas, and it was based off and driven entirely by the completion of daily quests. Together with the faction the Shattered Sun Offensive, players would help overtake the town of Sun's Reach in a set of stages, which was the point of the event. It was much more objective focused and goal oriented. There was only one major battle going on over a specific contested area, and it was spread out over longer time with no giant culmination at any point. It was a different feel to the types of events we'd seen before. Battle for Sun's Reach didn't have the same scale, but I think it had some benefits in being rather intuitive and simple. The latter might not always be a positive, but in this case I like the idea that you're working towards a clear goal and have a clear measure of success, overtaking the city. You could wonder how Blizzard dared attempt a zone-specific and zone-exclusive event like this with their past experiences, but I think they got away with it exactly because there was no culmination at any point. With the daily quest system, it was truly just one long, drawn-out battle. At the end of the Burning Crusade, we had the second Scourge invasion, also known as the Zombie Infestation mentioned before. It was the second pre-expansion event following the opening of the Dark Portal, and it helped set the stage for Wrath of the Lich King in style. Northrend would turn out to be dry land for one-time events indeed, but at the end of the expansion, the period of drought did come to an end with an absolute cloudburst. First, we had Operation Nomragan for the Alliance and Salazar's Fall for the Horde that both happened simultaneously towards the end of patch 3.3.5. Both events were pretty much identical in structure, but with different content. Operation Nomragan was the gnomes' retaking of the outdoor part of Nomragan and Salazar's Fall, the trolls' recapturing of the Echo Isles in Duotar. Players were able to participate through some short quest series that were more of a formality than anything else. They were really easy. Both culminated with a battle in some way, where you were fighting alongside High Tinker Mechatork or Vol'jin, and, after you were done and the battles had been mostly won, you'd be rewarded with an achievement and some other stuff. The last parts, the actual battles, were heavily reliant on the use of phasing, which would be the first time we'd really see the technology used for one-time events. Previously, we would have had a single server-wide battle for Nomragan and the Echo Isles, but phasing allowed Blizzard to create countless of phased battles for each area. Here, players could participate if they were high enough level and far enough into the respective quest series. It was quite a big change from what we'd been used to. Operation Nomragan and Salazar's Fall would pave the road for similar events later down the line, and we'd start to see more use of the phasing technology. It wasn't all bad news for one-time events as we'd known them, however. Following shortly after the Nomragan and Salazar events, we had the Elemental Unrest, also referred to as the Elemental Invasion, that took place mostly in patch 4.0.1 before the Shattering. The Elemental Unrest was a worldwide invasion of both Azeroth and Outland by Elementals. Elemental portals or rifts from where Elementals would spawn could appear in almost any zone in the game, which was a bit different from previous invasions where only a handful of zones had ever been targeted. Not just the outdoor zones felt the elemental rumblings, but most of the capital cities were also attacked on a scale we hadn't seen previously in one-time events. Well, you could argue the case for High Lord Krul, but that was a different type of attack. Starting in the last phase of the Elemental Unrest event, Stormwind, Ironforge, Orgrimmar and Thunderbluff would occasionally be the target of elite level elementals spawning from portals similar to those described before. The cities would go into a temporary state of emergency where all normal business would stop. Normal NPCs such as auctioneers would disappear, and the faction leaders would rally for players to help against the invaders. You could help by destroying the elite elementals, but you could also help by freeing captured residents and by placing down sandbags or similar stuff. The capital cities were evacuated, and you had to take action to ensure they returned to a normal state quickly. You couldn't just go about your normal business ignoring the fights around you totally. We had never seen anything like it before. The scripting required for a city invasion event like this was on another level compared to spawning a world boss outside Orgrimmar. Blizzard went all in, and thankfully the invasions were not phased, so the only version of Orgrimmar, for example, during an invasion would be the Orgrimmar being invaded. There were some other aspects to the Elemental Unrest, such as Doomsayers appearing in the main cities, earthquakes being felt, and more. It is one of the most elaborate one-time events we've ever had, but it also led up to one of the biggest overall game-changing events in the history of WoW, the shattering of the old Azeroth world by Deathwing. That brings us to the next expansion. We had a high point with the elemental unrest, but that was followed by a very low point with Faramore's fall at the end of Cataclysm. Faramore's fall was a scenario dungeon in Mist of Pandaria, but in the weeks before the release of it, a level 85 version was made available as sort of a preview or teaser, I suppose. The 85 version came with a Feats of Strength achievement and some special rewards, but even then I don't think it's fair to consider it a true one-time event. It was nothing like we'd seen before, meant in a negative way this time around. I don't think it did much to create hype for the next expansion compared to the Dark Portal Opens, the Zombie Infestation or the Elemental Unrest. And the main reason you would probably want to do it was for the achievement. The scenario was available in Mist of Pandaria anyways, so the content was still there, just tuned for a slightly higher level. In Mist of Pandaria, we had the first mid-expansion one-time event in a long time, meaning an event that didn't lead up to or happen shortly before the release of a new expansion. Battlefield Barrens was the event. It took place in patch 5.3 and was meant to set the stage and create hype for the Siege of Orkmar Wade in the following patch. As the name reveals, Battlefield Barrens was mostly centered on the Barrens or Northern Barrens more specifically, a zone that had undergone a lot of changes with the event. High-level creatures had been added, and a Horde and Alliance quest series that started in Pandaria. The changes to Northern Barrens would mostly remain after the event finished, but the primary quest and a lot of event NPCs were removed. It was the first time a low-level zone had been used for a purpose like this as far as I'm aware, and the concept would end up becoming quite popular at Blizzard, hopefully because player feedback was positive. The concept was used again for the very next one-time event, the Iron Horde Incursion, where it was the Blasted Lands' time for a makeover. The Iron Horde Incursion was the pre-expansion event for Warlords of Draenor, where Azeroth was invaded by Iron Horde Orcs coming from the Dark Portal. The basic premise was the same as the Dark Portal Opens event from the end of Vanilla, but in this case, the Blasted Lands was the only outdoor zone to be invaded, and the way it worked was a bit different. The remade or upgraded version of the Blasted Lands was level 90 only and phased, and I'm pretty sure you would experience a regular Blasted Lands if you were below that level. This was also different from the Northern Barrens changes that happened with the Battlefield Barrens event, where the updated zone could be accessed by anyone. The Iron Horde Incursion came with a number of quests that led directly up to the release of Warlords of Draenor and the counterattack through the Dark Portal that didn't take you to Outland anymore, but to Draenor. We hadn't seen that degree of continuity before between a pre-expansion event and the expansion, where the chain of events was tied so tightly together. The pre-expansion event here was the defense against the Iron Horde's invasion into Azeroth, and the journey through the Dark Portal into Draenor was the response in form of an offense that happened with the release of Ward. The changes to the Blasted Lands introduced with the event would remain after the event finished, and I believe almost all the content, including quests, would continue to be accessible as opposed to the Battlefield Barrens event before. Outside of the Blasted Lands changes, the Iron Horde Incursion also featured a level 90 version of the new Upper Blackrock Spire that had been remade for Ward. This was the same deal as with Faramore's Fall from the end of Cataclysm. Players could get a preview of the new instance, but it would continue to be accessible later, just tuned differently. I'm happy we had the outdoor Iron Horde invasion and not just the UBRS preview, which would have been immensely disappointing. The next one-time event was the Legion invasions at the end of Warlords of Draenor. We were back to the familiar and old faithful worldwide invasion type event that we had last seen with the Elemental Unrest almost 6 years earlier. The Legion invasions featured very extensive demon attacks on a number of different zones throughout Kalimdor and the Eastern Kingdoms. The invasions worked as following. Once a player entered a zone with an active invasion in the beginning stage, they would be phased into that shard of the zone or whatever the terminology is, and they would be able to participate. Multiple invasions could be happening in the same zone at once, and the scale of them were nothing like what we'd seen before. Whole zones would be under attack with giant demons walking around and fellfire raining from the sky. There were different stages with different objectives, and at the end a final demon boss would appear. It was definitely not the type of worldwide invasion we had been used to. Long gone were the days where there was only a single coherent game world for each server that was the same for everybody. It was clear that the technology and the game had evolved. At the same time, the basic premise of having a worldwide invasion was still the same for the Legion invasions as it was for the Scourge invasion or any of the other previous big invasion type events. Returning at the end of Legion leading up to Battle for Azeroth, we had another one of those quest-driven and story-focused events like we'd seen a few of already, but this one was arguably the most extensive yet. It was War of the Thorns that played out mostly in Ashenvale and Darkshore, culminating with the burning of Teldrassil. There was a long quest series available for each faction. From the Horde's POV, it was an attack on and invasion of Alliance territory in Ashenvale and Darkshore, and from the Alliance's POV, it was a defense against the invasion. It was the first time for a one-time event that we had this kind of direct Horde against Alliance battle going on that could be experienced firsthand from either side through a quest series. I believe it was also one of the first one-time events to use a longer cinematic as part of it, the Warbringer's Sylvanas cinematic that would play when Teldrassil was set ablaze. It shows the emphasis on the storytelling aspect, and it's a good way to build hype for an expansion. War of the Thorns was followed up directly by the battle for Lordaeron when BFA was released, which was the Alliance's reaction. You end Legion at such a high point like a cliffhanger and you want to see what happens next. It was the same type of direct chain of events we had with the Iron Horde incursion and the following attack through the Dark Portal in Ward. But the circumstances were arguably a bit more dramatic this time around, depending on your point of view. I think the Death Rising event that'll go live in retail on the 10th of November is a good example of some of the development we've had in one-time events. It has some elements that date back all the way to the beginning, the worldwide invasions that just work for a game like WoW. It has the zombie plague that's taken from the Scourge invasion in Wrath of the Lich King, but it also has quite a few quests and some of the more storytelling aspects that we've seen a higher focus on in recent years, in my opinion. It's a blend of many of the previous one-time events, and I think it shows some of the lessons Blizzard have learned of what to do and what not to do. Well, you never know what they might pull out in the future, and of course it's always a question of taste what people like and don't like, but I think they've found a good recipe, all things considered. I won't go into a greater discussion on how the gameplay and feel of WoW has changed over the years. It obviously affects our experience of one-time events as well. Being a classic fan, I might have an issue with some of the changes, but looking at one-time events in isolation and how they progressed and developed from Manila, I'm generally happy with a few exceptions. I think the premises behind most of them have continued to be epic. They're great for building hype for a patch or a new expansion if they're fun to play. They're clearly valued highly by Blizzard and are powerful tools. One-time events don't usually last very long, by nature they're temporary, but development time is still invested in them. We had the most in Vanilla, and in recent years they've primarily been used leading up to an expansion, so they have been deprioritized a bit. Still, they are clearly alive and well, and the awesome part is that we get to re-experience some of them in Classic. Thanks for watching the video, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. Take care, everybody.